Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. You sing.
The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is.
Hello, viewers all over the world. Welcome to the ever-increasing word feast. Eric Habwele is my name, and I'm back again to share with you the word of God, which is going to be of a great blessing to you. All I ask from you is get the pen with you, the paper and the Bible, that together we may adventure into the word of His grace. I'm going to share with you the word of God, which I have entitled as the name of Jesus. My first scripture reading is going to come from the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 15 to 17. The scripture says, "And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus." 16 says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness." 17 says, "That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." This was the time when Apostle Paul was admonishing his son in faith, Timothy. He was telling him to say, you know what, from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures. Now, this is the area where the Scriptures, they profit us. In 16, he said, all scriptures, pasagraphe, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine. Now, doctrine is taken from a Greek word called didaskalia, and didaskalia, it means learning or teaching, meaning all scriptures are given to us for learning. They are given to us for teaching, meaning your learning should be derived out of the scriptures. Any learning that does not come from the scriptures is a pseudo learning. It does not qualify to be part of learning. He also said the scriptures, they profit us in the world of reproof. Now, the word reproof is taken from a Greek word called elekos, and elekos, it means proof, it means conviction, it means evidence, meaning the scriptures, they've got to be your evidence in your life. Scriptures, they've got to be proof. This tells us to say, whenever you are found in the situation and the situation says you are cursed, the situation presents itself to you to tell you to say you can never go anywhere. And then when you meet scriptures, scripture says you can become anything. Scripture tells you to say in Christ you can do anything. It means scriptures, they are now acting as your proof. You need to get scriptures and present the scriptures to that situation. When you present scriptures to that situation will bow. What is the mission of proof? The mission of proof is to cancel arguments. The only thing that ends argument is proof. Once the judge, you show them proof, they will not even proceed with any judgment. No. They will just say, case closed. Why? Because there is proof that this thing happened. So the word of God is proof. When the sickness presents itself to you, you need to bring the proof of the word of God to that sickness to say, by His stripes I am healed. When you present the truth of the word of God, when you present proof of the word of God to that sickness has got no option apart from living. And then the scriptures, they are profitable in the way of collection. Now, collection is taken from a Greek word called epanothosis. And epanothosis, it means to rectify, to reform, or it means to straighten up again. Meaning, scriptures, they are the one which straightens us. You should not be headstrong. You shouldn't be a person who has grown above collection. You know, the in which you know is not the final. You should be submissive to the scriptures. You should be flexible enough that you are able to be collected by the scriptures. Don't say, me, I know it all. There is nobody who is above collection. You should be able to be collected by the scriptures. The mission of the scriptures is to electrify us, to straighten us. Meaning when you expose yourself to the scriptures, you become straightened. And then the scriptures, they profit us in the world of instruction. They instruct us. The word instruction there is taken from a Greek word called paideia. Paideia. And paideia, it means tutelage. Tutelage or chastening. Chastening. What is the mission of chastening? The aim of chastening is to bring the best out of you. In short, the mission of chastening is to bring the best out of you. The name Jesus. Why is it that there are some people who uses that name and that name it works for them, and there are some people who uses that name, that name seems not to be working for them? You might be the victim of such people who uses that name and that name never seems to work for them. I am going to show you what you need to do for that name to be effective in your life. I'm going to explain to you what you need to know and what you need to realize for that name to be effective in your life. In the book of Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6. First of all, before Jesus was born, there are some prophecies which went ahead of him, denoting his coming, denoting what he was going to do, denoting everything about him. There are scriptures which were written ahead of him. Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6, scripture says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace." All these names, they are talking about Jesus. This was the prophecy concerning Jesus. In the Old Testament, you will never find the word J-E-S-U-S. No, you will not find it there. But it is there in types and symbols. It is there. You know, the people of the Old Testament, they never had accurate details about Jesus. They never had accurate knowledge about Jesus. God, he showed them about the coming of Jesus. He showed them what Jesus was coming to do. But they never had an adequate knowledge about it. That's why they were prophesying about Jesus. But they didn't know exactly what they were prophesying about. Peter says, these people were inquirers. When they prophesied, they inquired, say, what are we talking about? So these people, they never had the accurate detail. Now let me explain this Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6. Let me read it again. "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." The Prince of Peace. See, the word wonderful there, the word wonderful is taken from a Hebrew word called pere. Pere. And pere, it means wonders of God's act of judgment and redemption. Wonders of God's act of judgment and redemption. So now, this name, wonderful, it denotes the redemption or the redemptive work that Christ was coming to give us. The redemptive work of God in Christ. And then it says, wonders of God's act of judgment. How is the judgment of God a wonderful act to us? It's because the judgment that was supposed to come upon us, the dreadful judgment that was supposed to come upon us, God, he judged it on Jesus. He judged it on Jesus. It is a wonderful thing to us because he never gave us what we deserve. And then the word Mighty God. Mighty God. The word Mighty God is taken from a Hebrew word called Giba Giba. And Giba Giba, it means strong, champion, chief. So this one was denoting to say, Jesus, he shall be called strong. He shall be called champion. He shall be called chief. So Jesus, he is the chief of all chiefs. And the word everlasting, everlasting, is taken from a Hebrew word called ad. Ad. And ad, it means without end. So this scripture was trying to tell us the coming of Jesus, he shall be the king who shall not have the end. He shall be the chief who shall not have the end. And the word prince there is taken from a Hebrew word called sir. And sir, it means a ruler or a captain. So this one is saying, Jesus, he is going to be a ruler. So Jesus, he is the ruler. Jesus, he is the one in control. Now, why have I explained all this? All these which are enumerated in the book of Isaiah, they are talking about Jesus. But he was being spoken, they were talking about Jesus in a shadow form. Now, an angel appeared to Mary and clarified everything to say, it is Jesus. In the book of Matthew chapter 1 verse 21, the scripture says, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. Before Jesus was born, it was communicated to his mother that his name is supposed to be called Jesus. What was the mission of Jesus? The mission of Jesus was to save mankind from sin. So the primary mission of Jesus Christ here was not to give you a car. The primary mission of Jesus here is not to give you a house. The primary mission of Jesus coming here on earth was to save you from your sins, was to save me from my sins, was to save mankind from his sins. Again, the scripture says from the book of Matthew chapter 1 verse 24 to 25, then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her first son, and he called his name Jesus. Meaning, before Jesus was born, it was communicated to his parents that when he will be born, he should be called Jesus. And when he was born, his name was called Jesus. And again, scripture says in the book of Philippians chapter 2 verse 9 to 10, the scripture says, wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. Now I want to collect something that has been going on in the body of Christ, something like, at the mention of the name of Jesus every knee shall bow. There is no scripture in the Bible which says at the mention of the name of Jesus. There is no scripture which says at the mention of the name of Jesus. The scripture says that at the name. Now, what is the difference between at the name and at the mention of the name? The word at, it means a fixed position or a state. And which is a fixed position or a state. The state itself is more than enough. Now let me take you back. I want to explain something. I want to open your mind, which will be of a great blessing. Let us start from verse 9. Verse 9 says, wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. Hey, see, this was the time when Jesus Christ died and rose from the dead. When he died and rose from the dead, he was given a new name. He was given a name. What was that name? That name cannot be the name Jesus again. That name can never be Jesus again. Why? Because before he was born, he was to be called Jesus. When he was born, he was called Jesus. He died and rose. God has given him a new name, which is Jesus. It cannot be. It doesn't make sense. If it was the name Jesus, it was going to be. He has confirmed, and God confirmed the name Jesus. Now, let me explain something here. The scripture says, wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. Above every name. The word name here is taken from a Greek word called onoma. Onoma. And onoma, it means a rank. It means a rank or authority. It means position. So what happened here was not that Jesus was given a name. No. Jesus was given a rank, or Jesus was ranked. See, when Jesus Christ was here on earth, before he died, his name was only working, was only effective here on earth. He casted out devils here on earth. And you know, other people, as he was still alive, he sent his disciples to go and cure the sick, to go and clean the lepers. They used his name and things happened. It was before he died. Now, before he died, his name was limited. His name was only effective here on earth. So when he died and rose again, God, he gave him a rank. Here where he says a name, it's a Greek word called onoma. And onoma, it means a rank. So now let's read. Therefore, God also hath highly exalted him and given him a rank which is above every rank. He has given him a rank which is above every rank. That at the rank of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. Meaning, the rank of Jesus has now been exalted, that when you mention that name, it does not only work here on earth. It works in heaven, earth, and under the earth. Let me give you an example. You have contested to become a mayor. When you win as a mayor, your power, it is limited to a certain legion. Your power is limited to a certain legion. Meaning, when you speak, your authority only influences that legion where you are a mayor. But when you contest again to be a president, and then you win, it means your position or your rank has shifted. Your position, when you say, you do not only affect the area where you were a mayor, you also affect other areas where you were not a mayor. This is exactly what happened when Jesus Christ died and he rose from the dead. When Jesus Christ died, yes, and rose from the dead, the rank, he was given a rank that at the mention of Jesus, anything in heaven, on earth, and under the earth has to obey. So it is the rank that Jesus attained, not a name. Because before he was born, he was to be called Jesus. When he was born, he was called Jesus. He dies and he rises again, he is called Jesus. No. It means the rank there. The rank was uplifted. Listen to what the scripture says in the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14, scripture says, "For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named." So, Jesus now is our family name. It is a state by which our families are known by. So, even without mentioning it, when you enter in the place, devils have to exist. That's why there I had to collect to say, it is not at the mention of the name of Jesus that every knee bows. No. At the state of Jesus. And Jesus is our family name. So you are in the familyhood of Christ. At the state where you are as a born again person, when you appear in the place, when there is Satan has to exist, the scripture says, you are the light. Anywhere light appears, darkness has to leave. There is no struggle between light and darkness. Whenever light has appeared, darkness has to give way. So it is the state of the name of Jesus. So when you walk in the consciousness of that state, everything begins to work out for you. When you walk in the consciousness of that name, you find that sicknesses begin to leave. When you walk in the consciousness of the name of Jesus, you begin to operate in the dimension which the scripture says you shall operate. So the scripture in the book of Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6, it was trying to explain Jesus. So Jesus, it means wonderful. Jesus, it means mighty God. So Jesus, it means everlasting God. Jesus, it means Prince of Peace. Jesus, it means everything. Let me tell you something. Because there are some people who think like when they call God Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Lover, things work out for them fast. No. You are not given Jehovah Jireh to call. You are not given Jehovah Lover. You are not given Elohim. You are given the name Jesus to call upon. That name, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Lover, Elohim, it is inside the name Jesus. When you walk in the consciousness of the name Jesus, Jehovah becomes your Jehovah Lover, which is the healer. Jehovah becomes Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah the provider. Jehovah becomes everything to you. All is covered in the name of Jesus. Amen, somebody. Hello viewers all over the world, this is all I had for you. Thank you for being with me up to the end. God bless you. Shalom, shalom.